in your accusation.
Can you go on?
Okay. Well, this is a central introduction to zero knowledge proof for blockchain developers. My name is Angel Lopez. My English is limited, but I hope that you could understand my English, my ancient English, that is a dialect of English. The idea is to explore why we have now this hot topic, a relative hot topic in Ethereum and other blockchain that is called zero knowledge proof. Well, it's not an easy topic to explain. So I share with you the link with a post where I list all the resources I read to prepare this presentation. The gentle introduction is gentle because part of the presentation does not employ mathematics, but other part yes, and the mathematics part is a bit hard. The main resources could be a really interested and simple explanation of what is zero knowledge proof to solve scaling in blockchain. You can download the report from this link. It does not employ mathematics. I'm going to explain many of this. Of the topics we will explore today. There is a site with many links to learn about zero knowledge proof. And there is some GitHub repository for MATLABs with many interesting and curated links about zero knowledge proof. And all this I put in my today blog post about what I read to prepare this talk. Well, you know that we are working in a blockchain that is similar to an Ethereum blockchain. An Ethereum blockchain, you can not only have a transaction, but also you could call smart contracts with logic and store. But if we take the transactions, even being a light transaction, they have problem to scale in Ethereum because every transaction should be executed in every node, and and the storage they employ, for example, the balance of each account should be kept in every node of the blockchain. You cannot run a lot of transactions because the quantity of transaction is limited per row. There are many limitations that apparently the Ethereum founders was aware from these limitations since the beginning, and they started to explore different solutions. And one of the things they found are to move the processing to off-chain. There are many approaches for this. For example, some weeks ago we had a talk about Bitcoin Lightning Network in the case of Bitcoin to have offline processing of transactions without using the main blockchain. In the case of Ethereum, we have the Raiden project that we ported as Lumino, and you can use offline processing to exchange tokens without using the main blockchain. And now we have zero knowledge proof, the new kid on the block maybe, but with some years in cryptography, instead of not only doing a computation out of the chain, but also gives a proof that computation was complete, because we need to trust something, to have a proof of that computation was executed, put that proof in the main chain. The idea of zero knowledge proof came from many decades ago from cryptography and logic, and now it can be used in the in the blockchain and Ethereum, especially in Ethereum, to scale, to solve the scalability problem. Zcash, for example, is a blockchain that is totally based in zero knowledge proofs since the beginning. And now we are, we have these ideas implemented in Ethereum. We also need to change, to add to our virtual machine new operation to support some cryptography operation, elliptical operation to support this new zero knowledge proof processing. If you like history, you can consult because it's very affordable. You can read this if you are a software developer and know what is a Turing machine. You can read this paper that is maybe the seminal paper that put that describe first time the interactive proof systems, because this zero knowledge proof initially was based on an interaction between two parts. We will see today that interaction now is not needed in the blockchain scalar, in the blockchain realm. But what is a zero knowledge proof? Let's go to see a simple use case. I don't remember the author of this use case, but it's very popular. So it's the Alice Boban and the balls. Suppose that Alice can, you have two balls with two colors, red and green. Alice can detect the color, can see the colors, can distinguish the ball by color. But Bob cannot. Bob cannot distinguish the colors, only see the two balls as equal balls. And then Bob want to be convinced that Alice could distinguish the balls, that Alice has an algorithm of something that Alice could give to Bob a proof that she can detect the difference between the balls. And at the same time, Bob will won't learn anything about that algorithm. That is the key part of the zero knowledge proof. There is a proof, but there is no transfer of new knowledge. To be clear, suppose that Bob has the two balls in a box separated into parts. The box cannot be seen by Alice. But then Bob show one ball to Alice, for example, the first one, the left one. Alice don't know which of the two balls in the box now Bob is showing to her. But to Bob is a gray ball. Then Bob returns the ball to the box. And the second interaction is it takes another ball, maybe the same, and show the second ball to Alice, and Alice say it has the same color that the previous one. And Bob say, yes, really, because I choose the same ball that in the previous interaction. So Alice is right. Okay, Bob returns the ball to the box, and then maybe in the next interaction, Bob shows the second ball. And then Alice say, it's different from the previous one. And Bob say, oh yes, Alice is right again. I choose the different ball. To me, I cannot see what the ball is different, but I know that Alice could detect if I using the left ball in the box or the right box in a ball in the box, even if I cannot distinguish the color, Alice is giving me a proof that he can. And if I repeat this iteration maybe 100 times, and Alice gives the right answer every time, then Bob will be convinced that Alice really could distinguish the balls. Then at the end, Alice gives a proof that she can see the colors based on repeated interaction. Bob is convinced that Alice can see the colors, but Bob still does not know the colors of the ball. He cannot say, "Oh, the left ball in the box is the green one." No, nothing. No knowledge was transferred from Alice to Bob. So in a way that Bob could assert such assertion. And Bob does not learn any method to distinguish the color from Alice. He cannot distinguish the colors yet. That is the idea. There is a proof, but not knowledge of no transfer of knowledge. Many times the proof is about a secret, but without sharing the secret. That is the good thing to analyze in this kind of zero knowledge proof. Imagine that you can prove that you have a password, but without revealing the password. That is one of the key things or important points for cryptography, the importance of zero knowledge proofs in cryptography, because the zero knowledge transfer, but a proof. Well, how we could use the zero knowledge proof for transaction? Sorry, any question?
No, all very clear.
Okay, thanks. Well, how we could use this zero knowledge proof for transaction? Well, it's a bit more complicated, but the idea is Bob and Alice or Bob knows that there are rules for transactions. For example, the account balance of the sender should be greater than zero, that what the sender gives should be the same amount that the receiver receives. The transaction should have a signature. The signature should correspond to the sender. There are a list of rules that Bob and Alice should know before establishing this kind of interaction. And this is the tricky part and the math part. These rules could be transformed in code, but not only in code, but also in many transformations, along many transformations, it could transform it to mathematical expressions. That is the hard part of the zero knowledge proof today. In short, the code could be transformed in what's called a zero knowledge circuit, not trivial step. The rules are established once. And then the circuit, based on the circuit, a program could be constructed, could be built, that is called a prover. A prover that, given the data of a new transaction, it could produce the proof that transaction occurs and comply with all the transaction rules established before. Also, a verifier could be built, a program that could verify that proof and could say, yes, that proof is valid. Why? Why not to send the transaction? Because if you need to validate all the transaction, all the data of the transaction, you need the balance of the accounts, you need the amount, you need the signature, you need all the things that you already know in the blockchain. You must to execute the transaction in the blockchain, and we will have again the scalability problem. The proof is shorter. The proof is shorter, and it could be verified quickly without using additional storage and without using a lot of resources. That is the key point. Instead of give you a total transaction, it gives you a proof only that the transaction occur in a valid environment that complies with the previous established rules for transactions. So you once only once you wrote down the rules, transfer it to a circuit, and then you can build two programs, the prover and the verifier. And then when you have a new transaction, the new transaction, the real data, Alice, two Ethereum, two Ethers, and Bob as a receiver, that is the and the signature of Alice, is given to the prover. The prover generate a proof for that transaction, and the verifier receive the proof and say, yes, okay, that transaction is valid, even without knowing the details of the transaction, even without knowing the balance, the signature, all the other things. As in Alice and Bob with the balls, the verifier has a way to verify that the proof is valid without knowledge transfer. Okay, but that is only for verify that a transaction occurs offline maybe. But if you see here, verifier say yes, is good or not, but nothing more. How we could employ that transaction data in a real blockchain? Well, again, any question? Okay. Well, in blockchain we need something more. I hope that I can explain this to you. There are many implementations. One is called SNARK, that is the proof is what is called succinct, is significantly smaller than the data that it represents. Notably, it not require interactions, so you can send the proof, and the proof and the verifier cannot don't need to interact with the prover, like Bob and Alice in the first example. So you send the proof and the verifier do all the things that it need to be do, but without interaction again with the prover. But it requires what is called a trusted setup. We don't know yet why they need that, but it's a process that generates a random data at the beginning to be used for every prover in the upcoming proof. It's a technical detail that maybe I could mention at the end of the slides. The other implementation is Stark, where you don't need that trusted setup, but the proof size is greater than SNARK. One of the links I put in my post is about a blog post that explains in more detail this difference. But how to use the proof in a real blockchain? Well, the offline processing will be executed, the transaction will be executed in other machines, not in the blockchain, because the blockchain, you know, has scalability problem. The transaction have a predefined rules that was transformed to a prover and to a verifier. And then you can exchange value offline, but at any moment you can back on chain again. It's similar in some way to we visited with the Lightning Network. There's offline processing, and sometimes you could back the processing online. Well, to explain this, the initial setup is you have a blockchain. There are many technologies. This is only related with one technology that is snarled with set key, what is called a set key rollup smart contract. In the initial setup, you have a blockchain. You have an special smart contract called set key rollup. And inside the rollup is the verifier, the program that could verify approve based on the pre-established rules to validate a transaction. And in the blockchain, you have a digital asset. In this case, Ether. Alice has maybe 20 Ethers at the beginning, and the special smart contract has 0 Ether at the beginning. But we need offline processing. Well, in this explanation, the offline processing could be maybe a blockchain or maybe only one machine that in this description we will call operator. The operator is not a smart contract, it's a program, it's a machine that contains a prover that could generate a proof given the computation of a transaction. Okay, this is the initial setup. In the operator, nothing. In the blockchain, Alice has value and the smart contract has 0 value. Well, to start to play, Alice start to fund the smart contract. He sent to the smart contract 15 Ether in this example. Okay, nothing more. He invested 15 Ethers in this smart contract, and then the operator could start manage that Ether offline. It's like when you fund a channel in the Lightning network, you put funds in a channel. Well, in this case, Alice put funds into the smart contract, the special rollout smart contract. Okay, but the operator could, the users could use the operator to transfer that value offline. See the next slide. Maybe in the operator, Alice informed to the operator, I transfer to Bob 3 Ethers. This is an off-chain information transaction. It's not reflected immediately in the blockchain. It's something that is only annotated by the operator machine. Then Bob say, oh, I could transfer from my 3 Ethers that I just received from Alice, I could transfer 2 Ethers to Charlie. Charlie say, well, I have 2 Ethers. I want to use these 2 Ethers in the real blockchain. I want to exit from the offline processing and I want to receive my 2 Ethers on the chain. Well, until now, all these transactions were offline, and now Charlie could say to the prover, please, prover, given all these transactions, please generate a proof of this transaction were valid and were computed and were executed. Okay, that is a job for Charlie, for the verifier under the order of Charlie. Oh, security is here. Well, the prover and then generate a proof that this transaction were valid. But you know, in the previous example, the proof is only saying yes, it's good or not. The verifier in the proof is sent to the verifier in the rollup smart contract, and the verifier say yes, okay, this transaction are valid, but the verifier don't know the transfers, don't know the amounts, don't know the users. Well, there is an additional error in this graphics. where all the data about the transaction is sent in a transaction to the blockchain. So the smart contract could receive the proof and the original data. But the original data is only sent in the cold data of the transaction. It never be executed, it never be stored in the distributed storage of the blockchain. It's only for this transaction processing. And then the reliable smart contract say, okay, this data, new data that was sent with the proof correspond with the proof. And those data say, okay, there are some internal transactions, I don't care about that, but there is something that is important to me that Charlie wants to ether. And then after verifying all this, the smart contract transfer two ethers to Charlie wallets. Sorry, I should correct the balance of the rollout contract. In this case, the rollout contract will have 13 ethers. Notice that rollout contract doesn't know about the bot balance, or the Alice original balance. The only thing that is important now is that Charlie exit with two ethers. And that exit was verified with a proof and was informed with a simple data included in the call data in the transaction that was sent to the rollup smart contract. Any question?
Yes, Angel, who controls the operator?
Sorry?
Who manages the operator?
It's like the nodes of the Lightning Network. Someone put the operator, it's a machine running this offline. If you disconnect this machine, you lost everything. It's like the nodes in the Lightning Network, as far as I know. It's a machine.
Okay. And another question, the information that the rollup smart contract receives is just a final state? So what are you sharing in addition to the proof? Are you sharing with the smart
contract? Yes, the additional data in some way say Charlie exit with two ethers, because the proof that doesn't say that the proof and the verifier say the proof is valid or not valid, but it doesn't know about one of the steps is that Charlie exit with two ethers. That additional data should be provided. That is what is called, I guess I put in the after for this talk, as the data availability problem. This is one solution, is to include the data in a cold data in the transaction as a cold data, not as a storage, as data to be storage in the smart contract, only travels inside the transaction and nothing more. But there are other solutions. And in the initial paper, in the initial report I described in this talk, there are a more detailed explanation.
Okay, thank you.
Any question? Well, now is the notion introduction, because I should talk a bit of mathematics. I still to learn a lot about these steps, but there are two series of blog posts. One from Vitalik Buterin explaining in three blog posts the SNARK, and other three blog posts the STARKs processing, and there is a seventh series, a post series from Zcash explaining their SNARK implementation. That is the hard part. because as we say, we should transform from the original code that represents the rules that what is a valid transaction to something that is, in this case, that we will explore now, a sec key snark. Well, the idea is that you must transform in many steps. One of the steps is transform the code you have to validate a transaction or something alike to what is called a circuit. It's a normal expression, it's a normalizing way to write down the code. In this case, I include only a computation with sums, with addition, and with multiplication. But you can also include in a formula taking decisions, like in an if or comparing numbers or something like it. It could be more complex. But at the end, you can transfer to a normalized form that is called a circuit. And this circuit is transformed notably to polynomials. It's very tricky, that transformation, and it's not evident. But why polynomials? Why to use polynomials in all this stuff? Well, remember that sometimes you could give information, but without revealing the original information. Well, in this polynomial evaluation, sometimes you need to evaluate something. Instead of giving the original data, in this case called X, you disguise the data with what is called an homomorphic hiding function. It's a function that is like a hash. You know, you can call, you have an input and you can transform using a hash function in something that is totally scrambled. Well, in this kind of EX function, the given EX, it's hard to find the original X, like in the hash. But also, you have that if you have different input, you have different output applying the function, something that maybe is not exactly in the hash function. But notably, there is something new. Knowing the disguised values, EX and EUI, you don't know exactly the X and the UI. You only know the transformations. But only knowing that transformation, you can calculate the transformation of the addition. You can compute EX plus Y from EX and from EI. You don't know X and Y, but still you could deduce some properties about the addition operation. This is something new that is very interesting because you can give information without giving the original data. For example, suppose that Alice wants to prove to Bob that she knows numbers that XY such that X plus Y gives 7. Instead of giving the original numbers, Alice wants to don't reveal that knowledge, but to prove that he has that knowledge. Then he could send to Bob EX and EY, the transformations. Bob computes EX plus UI from this value. Then he also compute E7. Given the properties of a homomorphic hiding function, EX plus UI should be equal to E7. Then if that equation is right, then Alice proved that he has the answer without revealing the original numbers. That is the magic of using a homomorphic hiding function. Then, in one of the steps, start to appear polynomials. And then instead of Bob asking Alice about evaluating such polynomial at the point S, also Bob tried to hide the original point as a random point applying the transformation ES. So Alice don't have any cue about the original point. That is in a way that Alice cannot deduce the answer expected by Bob, because Alice cannot really know the original question. It's only have an scrambled question. Bob say to Alice, please give me the value of that polynomial, but not in a clear point S, but I send to you the transformed point ES. That is more difficult to cheat. The other thing is how to transform from the circuit to the polynomials. Well, it's a tricky part. It's very long, and it's explained in detail in the Buterin pose and the Zeta cache pose. Alice gives knows original values for the circuit. Remember, the circuit has three inputs, A, B, C. And the circuit is fixed, but the Alice could have A, B, C as input, and Alice don't want to reveal all the input. Only want to say, Bob, I have input A, B, C that you don't know, that complies with all the rules that we established in the circuit and some polynomials. Then Bob, to try to challenge Alice, choose a random point S, but instead of sending the point S, Alice tries to resolve the ES evaluation of the polynomials. And then Bob receives the answer, and there is a relation that should be true. So to say, Bob, yes, Alice has the real answer, ABC, to this set of rules, circuits, and polynomials. That is the idea. Bob challenges Alice in many points, and those points are apparently random because they are transformed by the homomorphic hiding function. But remember, that is what is something similar what we both analyze with the balls, the use case of the balls. But there is something new in the last transformation. It is called to use, instead of simple numbers, to use numbers from the points of an elliptic curve. The elliptic curve started to appear here, not only elliptic curve, but also elliptic curve that support what is called a mathematical property of elliptic curve that is called pairing. Mr. Vescovo gave a talk about pairing one year ago. And with those pairing, there are two things that we could win. First, we don't need to have interaction. Second, we can also calculate multiplication of polynomials, and not only the add of two values in the E homomorphic hidden function. It's something new that appears only when you have an elliptic curve that is pairing friendly. That is the reason, because we are adding now in our node, and Ethereum also has now, a new operations of a new elliptic curve called BLS. The BLS is another elliptic curve that is pairing friendly and is used for this. It's very popular to be used in this zero knowledge proof processing. That is the other hard part. One part is how to transform the code to polynomials, and the other hard part is how to transform the challenge of evaluation of polynomials to something that is non-interactive, and also using, instead of simple numbers, to use elliptic curve points from a elliptic curve that supports pairing. That is a mathematical property that not all elliptic curve has. That is the twist that we need to add to elliptic curve to use them in this kind of proof. Okay, any question? Maybe you are all sleeping now.
No.
Okay. Well, that is well, question. I recommend the I will send this to the research and dev channel in this post from today. I put all the links, well, the links to the slides, the link to the report about the report I mentioned at the beginning, the hours on zero knowledge proof by Matter Labs, the illustrated primer is the report I mentioned, the two original papers that influence a lot some decades ago is mentioned here. And some gentle introduction without using math, and then switching to the not so gentle introduction, you need to read with more details and better explanation than me the three posts by Vitaly Buterin about snags and three posts about stacks implementation. But for the last, the non-gentle part of my slide, I use this from Zcash. There are seven posts explaining very, very well each of the transformation and the need for that transformation from code to circuit to polynomials to use homomorphic hiding, to use homomorphic hiding supported multiplication, and to use elliptic curves with pairing. It's a lot of things. One thing that is interesting is there is a protocol called the Pinocchio protocol that is similar to Bob and Alice at the beginning, Bob asking Alice many times. Well, that is the Pinocchio protocol described in a paper. In the case of pairing of elliptic curves, I mentioned that with about avoid the interaction between Bob and Alice. For avoid that interaction, snags needs what is called a trusted setup. The trusted setup produces what is called a common reference string that is nothing more than some random points to be used in the upcoming proof. But to be really random and nobody knows exactly how to produce the common reference string, many parties are invited in a process to generate indirectly that common reference string. That is the hard part for a snag. In the trusted setup, maybe I don't remember, but many hundreds of people helped to generate that common reference string that is only some random points to be evaluated in the future proof. Well, yes. Oh, there is some question here.
Angel, there was a question about proof size. how do you think about proof size?
I don't examine the in detail that problem. I only know that Starks has a bigger proof size than Snark, but unless Starks don't need a trusted setup, and if you change the implementation of an Stark, you don't need another trusted setup. If you want to implement again a Snark and a Snark, you must to provide a second trusted setup. That is the difference.
Thanks.
Mr. Recobo say that it is not possible not to use mats. Yes. Okay. Any question? I don't know if Mr. Len has the link for the
evaluation for today. So I will send later.
Okay. Alejandro Narancio say no. I don't know if he say I am aged or not. What?
No, because you were saying that we are sleeping, so no, we were not sleeping.
Okay. Well, I could say an English joke, yes. How many Solidity developers are needed to change a light bulb? No, because the light bulb is a smart contract, is already deployed and cannot be changed. Now you must know. Okay.
Thank you for the gentle introduction.
Okay.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Bye.